A good number of you have stayed for the second session, and I'm very pleased to see that. And before we turn the floor over to the moderator and the two speakers in the second session, I'd like to acknowledge the wonderful efforts of our team of translators, Cleo and Michael Weber. And Michael is a graduate and alumnus of the American College of Thessaloniki. He's doing a splendid job. I had a thought about Dennis Martinis and his report, and some of you may recall that Nicholas Burns, the first ever Dukakis lecturer, visited Thessaloniki in February of 2000 as the U.S. Ambassador to Greece. I think it's safe to say as a result of his lecture at the American College of Thessaloniki, he went on to be the permanent representative of the United States to NATO, and then the Under Secretary of State for Political Affairs. Good things happen. Nikephoros Diamandouros, an old friend, was the national ombudsman in Athens, and as a result of his speaking in the American College of Thessaloniki, he went on to Brussels as the European ombudsman. So I really have a good feeling about the McKinsey report. As a result of that splendid presentation just a few moments ago, I think everyone's going to be talking about it, and the mood is already starting to change, and that's really, really important. So thank you very much for that. Now I turn the floor over to a very, very good friend. I'm afraid to say an old friend, because you'll think of the age and not the duration of our friendship, which after all has not lasted so long. But Simon is a graduate of Anatolia. He has had a storied career throughout Europe. He retired not too long ago, having been a senior official in the European Commission. And this year, he has gracefully accepted an invitation to stand as our first Dukakis professor in public policy. So I thank him for that, and I asked him to take the floor and introduce our speakers. Simon.
Thank you very much, David. After an exciting first session, I'm hoping that we're going to have an equally exciting second session. The second session deals with items that the first session stressed as being very important, namely regulatory reform in one or another way. So what I'll do is I'll continue in English. In Greek, I mean.
And what I would like to say is that both our lady speakers will talk about topics that have to do with structural changes that our economy and political life need. And I'll start with Ms. Stefopoulou, who is the current head of Better Regulation Unit at the General Secretariat of the government. And she's also a lecturer at the National School of Public Administration. She has undertaken a number of projects on behalf of the Greek government in the fields of citizen-state relations. That's very important. And in items of administrative report, as well as policy analysis. She has also been a lecturer at the European Institute of Public Administration, and she was the organizer of the OECD review on the implementation of better regulation agenda in Greece. She's an expert on one-stop-shop regulatory reforms, and she graduated from the University of Athens and from the National School of Public Administration. What is very interesting in this case for me is that, contrary to numerous public administrative officials, she starts from the exact sciences, from physics, and then from physics she moved on to legal aspects of policy, of politics. So, Ms. Stefopoulou has the floor.
Ευχαριστώ πάρα πολύ καταρχήν για την πρόσκληση. Η Θεσσαλονίκη είναι μια αγαπημένη πόλη. Είναι η αγαπημένη πόλη κυρίως όχι για τις
ομορφιές. First of all, thank you for inviting me. I love Thessaloniki and I love this city not only because of its beauty but because of the public administration and the public officials of Thessaloniki in the last one or two years have expressed an excellent interest for training. They keep inviting us to Thessaloniki for seminars, for specific targeted actions for training, for example, management of public schools, state schools. what should teachers do who are not managers? And furthermore, I found the topic very interesting because this is exactly what our moderator just said. So far, I've been dealing with analysis of public policies, not the interface between the business and the political system. So what aroused my interest, and I'd like to underline, is that we are referring to two different social subsystems when we talk about business and politics. However, there are two social subsystems that are not fully differentiated. A point of maturation would be the differentiation of the subsystems. The judicial system has its own means, its own methods, its own differentiated procedures, and it's separate from business and separate from public administration. But when we come to the business system as opposed to the political system, are these two systems sufficiently differentiated? This is a question, a wonderful question. Where do we draw the line? Is there a line between these two systems? Is the line clear? Do we know and can we describe the rules, the goals, the aspirations of the one system as different from those of the other? I think that in the Greek case, and we'll see some examples from recent surveys that have to do with the public administration in Greece, we have a paradox that one system interferes with the other. The rules of the one are not so clear from the other. And this happens because there is a social framework of values that does not support the differentiation between the two systems. There is a Greek tradition of rent sinking. And all this climate creates this unorthodox conjunction of the two systems in the context of a wild capitalism, a wild, wild west, according to David Winsner. I don't know if it's west, but it's definitely wild. So let us start with business. And what are the basics, the basic points? What's the point of the business sector? What are the basics? To produce money and keep a balance between payment and non-payment. All systems have that, the positive and the negative, what we want to achieve and what we want to avoid. A collateral result is the shaping and implementation of political methods according to efficacy and productivity. But in Greece, business entrepreneurship produces money through state funding. And this is not differentiated from the political system. Similarly, the political system in Greece, if we go back to basics, not only in Greece, the basic goal would be to create broad consensus about public interest. And the main way to achieve it would be public administration. And that's where I will draw my examples from. However, in Greece, there are intertwined interests between politics and business. That's why corruption is maintained. And we'll see that in a minute. And there is an inertia in the political system in Greece, which means resistance, entails resistance to change, as we heard from the McKinsey report. And there is a lack of regulation, and I don't only mean the legal text, which is registered in an archive, but I mean how we enforce it, about politicians and political money, so that the lines are clearer between business and politics. The consequences of this unorthodox relationship between business and policy is a double crisis. They are so intertwined, the two systems, that the crisis we are experiencing in Greece could never be only in the economic sector and not in the political sector, nor could the political system be in crisis as it is without creating problems for our economy. The crisis of politics creates business crisis and vice versa. And when the two subsystems are in crisis, we have leads to this social unrest
τεχνοκρατικά σχέδια που και μέσα στα Υπουργεία κατά καιρούς διαμορφώνουμε.
All technocratic plans and schemes that we shape in the ministries are important, and all the wonderful recommendations and proposals we hear. However, what is missing is the vision. It's not the technocratic knowledge. There are technocrats in Greece, both in the business community and in public administration. And let me here illustrate how the interaction between business and politics makes itself known. First of all, there are numerous and detailed regulatory and legislative provisions. It's not just a bad political system that produces these regulations, but it responds to demands and needs of the business system. And with the help of public administration, which supports these numerous and detailed regulations because it gives them power, we've got this maze of regulations within which businesses try to survive. We also have complex and elaborate administrative processes and procedures. It goes without saying. And of course, procedures couldn't be easier under this system. There is a lack of competitiveness, and we've got some interesting examples I'm going to share with you from how the principle of competitiveness developed in Greece. Because in Greece, we imitate institutions and reforms and actions from abroad, but we don't implement them in their essence. We are a European Union that has been having an authority of competitiveness from very early on. But how this authority operates is a Greek way of operating. We've got the institutions, like all European states, but we don't have the results that they have. Thirdly or fourthly, we've got closed vocations and educational fields of closed activities. They are not part of business, of the business sector. Let me give you examples. Numerous detailed legislative and regulatory provisions. And as a result, to control this, we've got numerous and complex and elaborate public administration procedures. This was a research we carried out that shows the regulatory production after 1974, from 1975 to 2005. We talk about 171,500 and something legislative texts. If you are interested, I can send anything to you. How many pages, what fields of policies, and so on. But what I'd like to highlight is that laws and legislation is 3% of that, of all these regulations and provisions. But regulation is anything that affects our life. When I need to submit anything to a public authority, I don't know if this is a presidential decree or this is a law or this is something else that demands this. 70% are 114,905 ministerial decisions. Let me stress here, and I come to what Mr. Gray said, ministerial decisions don't have any kind of evidence of transparency. They cannot be checked when they are being prepared and implemented. Law has to go through a specific procedure, and it's a standardized procedure, despite the resistance from various centers. Anyway, the law is being discussed and passes in the Parliament, despite the weaknesses it might have, because they have to be posted, consultation needs to take place before they pass, and so on. However, the 70% of the text produced, the regulation techniques, producing ministerial decisions, we are never informed about it. And sometimes we are not informed afterwards, unless we come up against the wall of this production. That's where we as citizens should demand transparency. Here it is where business people should demand transparency. We only aim at the members of parliament because they produce bad laws and vote in parliament. When the laws have arrived in the parliament, have passed through the ministerial offices. But it isn't the minister who prepares the law or drafts the law. The legislation and the main body is created within public administration. The texts are written there. So look, from 1975 to 2005, these first 30 years, the percentage of law, a law should be general. Should be general rather than specific and concrete. That's the blue part. So when democracy first started, there was a high percentage of blue legislation. See how we lose that. It dwindles as time goes on. Focus on the blue that has to do with European law. Our parliament has become a mechanism for ratification. They never discuss these laws. They just pass translated as they are according to the agreement, usually in two languages, in English and in Greek, or any other language in Greek. There is no discussion on them, and our parliament is a ratification mechanism. So remember, 3% of legislation, and look from this 3%, because that's only the 3% of the laws, what a great percentage, more than 50%, is ratification. So the parliament produces law for Greece to a percentage of 1.5%. Only 1.5% is produced by the people we vote for, despite the, within the constraints they have. This maze of a system leads to numerous detailed regulations for small entrepreneurship. For major entrepreneurship, public projects and works and so on, telecommunications, which opened as a sector in Greece in 2001. For SMEs, though, these regulations are very specific, very detailed, and in essence, it's very difficult to sail through them without the help of a consultant. Even with a consultant, it's difficult. For example, one of the markers or the index, the indices of the World Bank, and this is what rates are so low, is how contracts are executed. When there is an economic dispute and somebody goes to court, in Greece, in order to resolve this dispute, one needs to go through 39 different procedures, not steps, procedures. Each procedure has a series of steps. Over a period of 819 days on average to resolve this, and it will cost to the person who wants to resolve the issue 14.4% of the value of the dispute. Another thing that is also very impressive is to see that there is never one law that describes any procedure. If you want to start a business in Thessaloniki, for example, a bakery, you'll open the latest document about bakeries. But you have to look at the back, and in order to reconstruct the procedure through the legislative texts, physics, which has helped me a lot, raised its arms. It couldn't do very much. What you see is such a procedure. It's a procedure that doesn't exist anywhere. We reconstructed it from the legislative and regulatory texts, and it was 216 in this case. It's the procedure that one should follow to establish and install a manufacturing business somewhere in Greece. It could be a big industrial unit, plant, it could be a small bakery. This procedure comprises, as you see, of these yellow intersections that lead to 120 different courses or routes, itineraries. So starting from the top and saying, okay, I'll start a bakery, they could go this way. This one is for a major plant in an industrial area. another course if there was less environmental impact, another itinerary if there was no waste, and this last box at the bottom might say that you don't need a license. Indeed. So it's typical that even a small example, those businesses that create the κοινόχρηστο for the blocks of flats, they have to follow this procedure and say you don't need a permit, nor an environmental impact, because it's very simple and you can do it easily. And let me remain here, insist here. It has been measured by the Dutch government that the cost of bureaucracy in Greece is 6.8% of the GDP. So you can well understand how important it is today for us when it entails so much money, about 13, 14 billion euro, the cost of the interaction of the business with the political system, the administrative system. The time you pay your accountant to run to the tax office. That's the cost we talk about. Let's talk about the competition authority, which since it was established, it was just an onlooker on what happened in Greece. But it can play a leading role. Until 2001, there was a core legislative text with a few exemptions from the competitive law. The law was a translation of the good British laws or German laws, but this law had many special provisions, ministerial decisions, presidential decrees, special provisions that really worked against the principle of competitiveness. For example, there was a provision that with a common ministerial decision by the Minister of Finance and Development, we could exempt enterprises, they could be exempted because of national interest reasons. I was impressed by it when I read it. In December 1997, they signed state procurement agreements up to 3.5% of the GDP. A year before, the European directive came to force, which forbade this. And 1 year before was a year that we had asked to be given as an extension for Greece. And within this 1 year, they signed this type of contracts. So how can we talk about a principal authority as a public service, but as a principal, as an authority? Up until 2001, anything that had to do, decisions by the Commission that didn't allow merging of major companies due to competitive principles. Until 2001, only two such forbidding decisions had been issued, although we didn't have only two such merging plans. And one of the two was annulled by a ministerial decision. Today, things have changed recently. It's a law during the crisis it was drafted, and we have to change. They are things we should have done long time ago. Today, the authority of competitiveness can intervene through regulations in various economic sectors. It has extensive auditing competences and can take security measures if they think that regulations and provisions are violated concerning competitiveness. A final thing before I stop the examples and we go on to the plan and what we can do from now on are the closed vocations and whole fields of economic activity, which we heard earlier about tourism and cruising in Greece. Telecommunications, for example, were liberated institutionally the 1st of January 2001. For all the European member states, the directive was the 1st of January 1998. Greece asked for a 5-year extension until 2003. We didn't get till 2003, we got till 2001. I don't want to answer this, but was that to the benefit of the Greek economy? That battle for OTE to remain a monopoly until 2003, and how this could have helped to the development, to the growth of the Greek economy. Such battles took place every day, and it was our political system and the business system that defended this type of extensions. Finally, let's talk about major, grand and petty corruption that we read about in literature. Because in Greece we don't have 50% of SMEs up to 10 employees. We've got major businesses that also participate in these intertwined interest exchanges. And this happens because there is no social disapproval. Not only there is tolerance, but even approval. And this is what we heard about the lake and the waters receding, because all the more want to learn, and we've got examples such as the Avia, transparency. It might be difficult, but one can learn, can search. Even the sense of the person who makes the decision of exposing themselves, and somebody may check what your contract is and what you have spent, might make some people participating in this kind of networks to stop doing what might not be ethical. They might not be illegal, but they are not ethical. So there is no pressure to measure effectiveness so that we can reduce corruption. Corruption is reduced not with punishment when you discover somebody corrupted. It is prevention. You have to reward and measure the effectiveness, the efficiency. That's what public administration should do, be able to measure its efficiency. Major corruption appears in major products and procurement. That's grand corruption in the public sector. And petty ones in services. But we don't want to be symptomatic in our approach. We want to be systemic. So this is an opportunity. Not because a crisis is an opportunity, but because attitudes change, mental frames change. The system cannot work anymore like that. Not only the political system was disputed, it is collapsing. You see where things are today. Therefore, the crisis in Greece is an opportunity to move ahead. What are the five things they can do to move ahead? In the four subsystems that make up the Greek reality, the political system, the business system, the administrative system, and society, they can take specific actions and reforms targeted, not only as actions that will be one-off and forgotten, but they will be connected and intertwined one with the other, towards a vision, towards a strategic plan to create the Greece we want. Not only Greece for a business or Greece for a state, but Greece where we study, where we work, where we bring up our children, the country we want to live in as citizens, as employees, as business people. Let me highlight public administration. I'm talking about sound legislation. And good legislation is one of the basic principles in the EU, not only the quality of regulations and laws, but the way they are produced. To a great the great extent of the quality of a final product, a regulation, has to do with how they are produced. Transparency, analyzing the consequences, impact assessment, all these means and tools used by the Western world for decades now have been expressed to Greece by OECD in 2001. So since then, there is a law draft for good legislation that moves from one minister's drawer to another. And I don't mean just the government that changes. I mean every change of minister within the same government. And no strategy lasts for 8 or 9 months, because within 9 months, ministers usually change. So what we have achieved is an obligation through the memorandum. There is a law that says we need to record how a legislative text is produced. But who deals with this issue until the law draft arrives at the parliament? How does the consultation take place? Where does it go first? Who deals with it? Do you talk with the clerks who have never seen a field, if you're talking about an agricultural or a farming issue? Who do you consult with? And this was a law draft that circulated from 2001, and the memorandum imposed it as an obligation, and we are lucky they did, because we need to have a kind of mapping for producing regulation. The law passed after 2 years of delay. The memorandum wanted it in December 2010. It passed in 2012. And of course, it hasn't been enforced, because nobody accepts to agree, for example, for regulatory planning. Every minister should say to these executives, the minister's office, the prime minister's office, the planning of the regulatory work for the next 6 months. Who will coordinate the production of regulations? The Ministry of Finance incorporates European directive as a taxation decision, and they thought that they were responsible, whereas another ministry considered they were competent. We need to analyze and see the impact of administration. And this is the new law, 4048, which I think, I am afraid, might stay in the drawer without enforcement if we don't exercise pressure as state officers or as citizens. We need to make demands, and we need to implement the frameworks that will lead to evaluation and assessment of civil servants. Thank you very much.
I'd like to thank Mr. Fopula very much for a very interesting presentation. It was an eye-opener for me, at least, on many subjects, including how hardworking Greek ministers are, who, with a little bit imaginary accounting, have as a result that they work really, really hard, because it means that each minister in Greece in the last 30 years came up with one ministerial decision. It is a very significant result.